So, good afternoon, evening, morning, wherever you are. We're up for the final presentation of today, coming from Marina Villanueva-Diaz. She is the global technology leader for automated design of Jacobs, which is a $15 billion, 60,000 employee engineering firm with projects all over the world. So, this is a great presentation. And the title is Empowering People, Transforming Engineering from Citizen Development to High-Value Technical Delivery. Wow, that's a great title as well. Marina, welcome. Thanks that you're here. Please take it away.
Thank you so much, and thank you for having me. It's a pleasure to be here with you all today. All right, so let's start with a question. What can we do as an industry to improve our work-life balance? Yes, I said work-life balance. I've dedicated my entire career to process improvement and digital transformation, and this is not by coincidence. In fact, since I was born, I've been surrounded by very close relatives who have worked in the AEC industry. My dad, for starters, was a civil engineer and a construction manager. Two of my uncles have also been construction managers. My cousin, my husband are civil engineers. I have another cousin who's an interior designer, and I myself, I'm an architect. And I've seen it in small companies, medium-sized companies, big companies. The workflows and the processes that we use are of a different era, are from the past. And the fact these process inefficiencies have had serious implications, serious health implications, I would say, in some of my close relatives. One of my uncles suffered a heart stroke due to stress. My dad himself had to take several times leave due to stress issues. And all of us working on the design and the consulting side, I'm sure you will all relate to this. Tight deadlines, impossible milestones, long hours. And this really shouldn't be like this. We are unfortunately used to working under stress and generally consider this normal. But should it be normal, and can we do something about it? My name is Marina Villanueva. I'm the Global Technology Lead for Automated Design at Jacobs, an American international technical professional firm. And the situation we live is actually exacerbated by several factors these days. The industry is challenged with shorter timeframes and higher quality expectations. For example, Jacobs is delivering giga projects in the Middle East with insane deadlines and really, really impressive expectations from the clients. There's also more and more awareness and a higher desire to deliver more sustainable solutions. So sustainability requirements, energy performance, embedded carbon calculations, life cycle costs are more often than not part of our deliverables or are included in our design requirements. Another technical challenge, and I'm pretty sure you will all relate to this, is the still low digital adoption that the architecture, engineering, and construction industry suffers from. Still, we, like I was saying at the beginning, are not making use of technologies as we should, and we are still using workflows that that are very disconnected and very inefficient. And the last challenge I want to highlight as well, which is also quite significant, is the fact that our workforce, the people working in this industry is aging. Many skilled professionals with a long tenure in the profession are approaching retirement, the retirement age. And that is a big risk for companies because it can imply that this knowledge is lost unless the companies and firms implement ways to retain this knowledge and transfer this knowledge within the organization. So what can firms do about these challenges? Usually, two main strategies, I would group them into two groups. The first one is work smarter, invest in better processes, invest in process improvement, which can range from correcting simple problems to designing new processes altogether and anything in between. Another one, and we will talk about this one in more depth in this presentation, has to do with automation development, software development in general, and I would also extend this to anything data science related as well. And then on the other hand, the other strategy around knowledge management has to do with upskilling programs, investing in continuous learning, and then accelerating knowledge transfer. So implementing ways in the organization so that the deep domain expertise that has been accumulated through decades of experience by some of the most senior professionals is not lost and it's transferred to the younger generations. And generally speaking, there are like two well-accepted models to try and drive change in organizations. The first model is what I refer to as the distributed model, or we can also think about it as the citizen-led model, whereby growth or dissemination of change happens organically. And the other one is a centralized approach, whereby a team of people is mobilized to strategically plan and drive change in a controlled and managed way. We're gonna take a look at these two models separately, and we're gonna have the opportunity to discuss the advantages and disadvantages of each of these two models. So I have a little video to illustrate the citizen-led model. It's a little bit old, so please excuse that the quality of this video isn't fantastic, but please pay attention to the words. The words are much more important than the actual images.
If you've learned,
hope you enjoy it.
Learned a lot about leadership and making a movement, then let's watch a movement happen start to finish in under 3 minutes and dissect some lessons. First, of course, a leader needs the guts to stand alone and look ridiculous. But what he's doing is so simple, it's almost instructional. This is key. You must be easy to follow. Now here comes the first follower with a crucial role. He publicly shows everyone else how to follow. Notice how the leader embraces him as an equal. So it's not about the leader anymore. It's about them, plural. Notice how he's calling to his friends to join in. See, it takes guts to be a first follower. You stand out and you brave ridicule yourself. Being a first follower is an underappreciated form of leadership. The first follower transforms a lone nut into a leader. If the leader is the flint, the first follower is the spark that really makes the fire. Now here's the second follower. This is a turning point. It's proof the first has done well. Now it's not a lone nut and it's not two nuts. Three is a crowd and a crowd is news. A movement must be public. Make sure outsiders see more than just the leader. Everyone needs to see the followers, because new followers emulate followers, not the leader. Now here come two more people, then three more immediately. Now we've got momentum. This is the tipping point, and now we have a movement. As more people jump in, it's no longer risky. If they were on the fence before, there's no reason not to join in now. They won't stand out, they won't be ridiculed, and they will be part of the in crowd if they hurry. And over the next minute, you'll see the rest who prefer to stay part of the crowd, because eventually they'd be ridiculed for not joining. And ladies and gentlemen, that is how a movement is made. So let's recap what we've learned. If you are a version of the shirtless dancing guy, all alone, remember the importance of nurturing your first few followers as equals, making everything clearly about the movement, not you. Be public, be easy to follow. But the biggest lesson here, did you catch it? Leadership is over-glorified. Yes, it started with the shirtless guy, and he'll get all the credit, but you saw what really happened. It was the first follower that transformed a lone nut into a leader. There's no movement without the first follower. See, we're told that we all need to be leaders, but that would be really ineffective. The best way to make a movement, if you really care, is to courageously follow and show others how to follow. When you find a lone nut doing something great, have the guts to be the first person to stand up and join in.
So, just to recap the main lessons from this dancing guy. Citizen-led movement needs to be very easy to follow, and the focus should be on showing everybody else how to follow, nurturing first followers as equals, making it about the movement, not you. So that's very, very important. And I've seen movements of other natures fail because the leader made it about them and not the movement. Building momentum and making the movement public. So show what you're doing, share it with the rest of the world within your organization, and if you can't, outside of it as well. I think one of the last sentences in the video is also very relevant in this case. Is here is not really about leadership. It's about followers, because they are the ones who make the movement. Right. So this is how you create it. This is how you start and run a citizen-led movement or initiative. This is how you drive change through citizens. But let's not forget that a citizen-led movement also has risks, especially as we're talking about citizen development, in particular about working smarter and making processes more efficient, right? Let's not forget that in our context, we're talking about improving engineering processes. So some of the risks of citizen-led initiatives are that they are usually ungoverned. They also have the risk of growing really slowly. It really depends on the followers and their ability to be followed and make it easy to follow and help each other. Sometimes what happens with these citizen-led movements is that you get a good quantity of developments, a good quantity of initiatives going on, but not necessarily good quality and not necessarily good value. Unless, of course, these risks are mitigated and addressed and understood. And then on the other hand, we've got a centralized approach. And the centralized approach involves dedicated resources, executive endorsement, a governance process, and of course, it also comes with financial accountability, right? So when you are in a big organization and the organization promotes, in this case, design automation or process improvement, they want to make sure executives and business managers logically want to make sure that the investments are resulting in benefits and in efficiencies. I also have a video to showcase what that means at Jacobs. If we could play this video, please.
Design automation is really around improving how we deliver, both from a productivity standpoint, so we can do work, remove mundane tasks, processes, steps in the technical delivery aspect of our projects, and do things of higher quality.
So we have been working on two things over the last couple of years. One is developing a design automation playbook, which is aimed to help people across PNPS take ideas from the very early ideation stage through to an automation that is deployed and used in the business. So that helps people follow a very structured approach, a very structured process to help mature the ideas, put together a business case, get it approved, and then start the development process and then scale and help people adopt the solution.
Really what we're aiming to do is provide the resources and support and framework for these tools to get into other markets and other regions across the business.
We are here to support people through the journey of change. Mm-hmm. So we're here to support them in understanding what they're currently doing to what the future state looks like.
Certainly in 3 years' time, design automation will be fully embedded in the business. So we have defined process for how we take initiatives from an idea all the way through execution. We're always looking to gain an edge on efficiency, to be maintain leadership in our delivery, industry leadership. Certainly been quite a journey.
So I suppose one of the perks of a centralized approach is also that you get to produce nice communications like these ones. But it isn't perfect either. It has some limitations. For example, in the design automation program, we over the last 2 years have primarily focused on what is normally known as a push system. So we have based our investments on forecasted demand. So what that means is we have estimated how many people would adopt a particular process or a particular tool or a particular improvement. And this comes with certain risks in terms of adoption, because you are estimating upfront how many people will eventually want to adopt the new solution, and you're doing it from a centralized function. The results of that vary a lot. We do have tools that have been very successful and others that haven't been as successful. So there is a chance in this scenario that you accumulate some stock, really. Also, in terms of limitations, given it's a centralized team with a set number of resources, our ability to scale is limited by design. And so it is, to some extent, hard to scale this model. We only have the capacity to deliver as much every year. And so we have evaluated these two models, and none of them are perfect. They both have limitations, and as we were thinking about this situation with the team, we said, okay, so maybe there is a third model. Could we do something to combine the power, the benefits, the advantages of these two models, and see what happens, right? And as Aristotle said, virtue is in the golden mean between two vices, the one of excess and the other of deficiency. So what we did was just that, combining the two models. And as I was saying, on the one hand, for the last couple of years, we've been working on citizen development and on a growing community of practice that has gone from around 100 people to 800 people in just 2 years. We have monthly show and tells. We've implemented Victor since January this year. We have been promoting Git for source control across the line of business. We have been promoting internal consultation with IT to mitigate risks around quality of these developments. And in terms of upskilling, let's not forget about that. We have also been developing training programs and have made them available in our learning management system. And then in terms of creating new solutions, we have created new and scaled existing solutions. As a central team, we have defined an incubation process to find and prioritize ideas. We have a central team of product owners, software developers, marketing, organizational change management working together to roll out these new solutions and ways of working. And in this function, in this pillar of the program, the priority has been lifespan of these solutions and maintainability. We have done a ton of stakeholder engagement, and change management is always ongoing to help people adopt new ways of working. And this year, to maximize impact, we are implementing a third element, a third pillar, also to compensate the defects or the limitations of the push system I was talking about just now, and start implementing a pull system to expand the impact that automation can have across the business. So that means our objective with this third pillar is to deliver solutions on demand, deliver fast, deliver across the business, across projects. And in this case, because it's in the middle, the prioritization is effectiveness and time savings and quality improvements over lifespan or maintainability of the solutions. In some cases as well, automation on demand, we are sure will set the stage for an enterprise investment, for a bigger solution. And in terms of performance, I wanted to share with you what that has meant so far, what this journey has meant so far for us. We have developed around 10 tools that are used globally through this program. Since January, 32 applications have been developed by the community at Jacobs, and around just shy of 500,000 hours have been removed from projects, which is a great success for us. But let's be honest, it hasn't been easy. There have been bumps in the road, and I also want to share with you some lessons learned, and hopefully that will hopefully resonate with you. The first one is measuring value. Like I said, this is a centralized approach mostly, but whether it is a centralized model or a distributed model or a hybrid model that you're following or thinking of following, demonstrating value is hard, yet it is very important for business managers and executive stakeholders. So if I can recommend something, is invest in tracking mechanisms, invest in measuring how much your solutions are being actually used, because this will help you create momentum within the organization and will help you persuade those who might be more resistant to change. Of course, work with IT to get usage data. And also, let's not forget about qualitative data. Tracking mechanisms and working with IT is great for quantitative data, but in terms of qualitative data and understanding how people are perceiving the solutions that we are rolling out is very useful, and it's important to establish a feedback loop with the end users. The second one, around managing risk. I mentioned the risk of poorly developed applications or poor quality assurance, especially in citizen-led initiatives. So to mitigate this, it's very, very important to enable transparency and inform users of the state or status of the solution. So we are encouraging everybody in the organization to explain the limitations of their solutions, to be very transparent about their version, who the authors are. We are promoting best practice with the community, of course, and celebrated the solutions that are vetted and check all the boxes in a way. But then also in terms of accountability, and this is probably more on the cultural side or a segue to the cultural resistance element, is that in reality, in engineering, you can't blame the tool. The end user, the engineer, the project team is ultimately responsible of choosing the tools they use to produce valid results, right? Whether it is commercial software or in-house software or citizen-led developments, the solutions produced in-house should provide enough transparency so that engineers can be confident that the results produced are correct. But it's ultimately their responsibility to check that and own the results. In terms of cultural resistance, I'm sure all of you working in digital transformation or involved in these types of initiatives can recognize a guy like the one in the slide. So folks who are risk averse, well, the way to fight that, the way to counterbalance this risk aversion and sometimes also generational gap, is to share success stories. But I will say more, leadership support is the number one driver of change. So if your organization is convinced that digital is the way and that there's no going back, then change will happen. And then in terms of the learning curve, you'll be dealing with varying skill set levels and overcoming the barrier of entry to programming. So provide technical support and foster a community and do invest in upskilling your staff. And to conclude, just to say a few words to conclude this presentation, despite the winding and bumpy road, let's be optimistic. We are transforming the industry. We are improving how we work. We are increasing the productivity of the industry thanks to digital transformations and thanks to both citizen-developed initiatives and enterprise investments. We are increasing the value of the solutions we deliver and are doing so in a more sustainable way. We are making our organizations more and more competitive by doing so. And we are, in fact, retaining knowledge when we are creating software. Software development is a great way to create intellectual property and retain intellectual property within the business. So that's a good way to retain knowledge and transfer it faster. And ultimately, my hope is that through all this effort, we eventually also contribute to making our lives better. I'm sure that all of us and also our families would massively benefit from less stress, having more time for what matters both at work and at home, a healthier workplace and better work-life balance overall, thanks to better processes and more efficient processes. Thank you so much.
Wow. Thanks, Marina. Thanks for a very nice presentation. Really like the personal touch you mentioned about making life better. Here we obviously very much align. Automate the boring, engineer the awesome is also about getting rid of the mundane work. So we are actually on time and we have to do some closing words. So let's do one question. So do you consider Jacob's leader a fast follower or the early majority in terms of automated design, if you see it from an industry perspective?
It's a good question. I consider us a leader.
Nice. So we should be fast following to make a movement, right?
Yeah, of course, of course. it's a never-ending process.
Yeah.
So transformation is happening all the time, and now, well, we are implementing the technologies that are available to us right now. But in 5 years' time, there will be new technologies that we will have to adopt, and that is a never-ending process. We can never stop the transformation.
Is the process itself also changing, do you think? If you, let's say, are you going to do things very differently next year?
No. So the plan is to continue doing things the way I explained in the presentation. So continue creating momentum around the citizen development community, continue delivering automations on demand, and continue investing in the bigger elements, the bigger items through enterprise investment.
Cool. That's very nice. And not a lot of people know, maybe, but hey, you explain it very nice from an enterprise and leading perspective, but you also create your own applications on Victor now and then. For instance, you've created the ROI app. So people actually, when they have an idea, they get into a Victor application to create a business case, which solves also saves quite amount of time.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, I did that because I know the importance of demonstrating value and demonstrating return on investment in front of business stakeholders. So to make it easy for citizen developers, I created that application. And it's been very successful. I didn't expect that, but I'm glad that it is helping.
Cool. Well, thanks, Marina, for your time. And your contribution to this event. And now Roland and I have to jump out because we have to go to physically another room for some closing words, but you can stick around in your digital environment so you don't need to change any room. Thanks, Marina.
Thank you very much.
Bye.
Bye.